Greetings, collectors, followers and friends. Tom Hughes here with some more thoughts on pancakes, painting. It's 5 o'clock in the morning and today we're doing an experiment. I'm going to go to a specific spot, and paint for 10 to 12 hours straight in an attempt to try and capture the movement of the sun, the changing of the weather, all within one day. And see how many paintings I can do. This is what I'm eating for breakfast these days. Blueberry pancakes. If you're interested in how I make these, let me know in the comments and I'll cover that in a future video. But for now, I'm going to enjoy them, have my coffee, and I'll see you at the spot.
Well, here we are in Avon Gorge, and this is the spot. It's somewhere I've painted quite a few times. There's my bike levitating. It's a spot I've painted at quite a few times, but I'm normally up there on the bridge, but I don't want to spend a whole day, 10 plus hours, standing next to traffic, so I've come down to this little peninsula. Which is much more, it's still noisy, but it's far more serene and isolated than up on the bridge. I've never done this before. I've never painted one spot all day. It's cloudy, isn't it? The initial plan was to do this on a completely clear, sunny, cloudless day, noon until dusk, so you'd see the light, you'd get a real sense of the sun transitioning through the sky, which is normally what people do, because if the weather's changing throughout the day, it's hard to get a sense of continuity and time of day. But this is England, and variable weather is sort of part and parcel of living here, unfortunately. Excuse me. And I'm too frustrated, I'm too impatient, so I can't sit around waiting for that perfect day. It's probably never going to come. So I just thought, just get up and do it. The weather forecast is overcast, really overcast, sort of dark cloud, then clearing up at around 4, and then bright sunshine. So that's a wide gamut of weather, so it might be quite interesting. How bored I'm gonna get after my fifth painting is another matter. As I said, I haven't done this before, but if I can keep the energy up and I can keep my concentration up, I think it could be a really interesting, fruitful experiment, because I really do want to be able to show that passage of time. Loads of plein air painters do it, or have done it and still do it, and one thing that's quite common is, more so when it's a consistent sunny time frame, but people will frame sometimes 3 or 4 or even 5 paintings within one frame in a sort of landscape, triptych or diptych or quadruple tick, whatever, and then you hang that on the wall as a group and you see the sun moving on each painting. So although I'm coughing, clearing my throat, I am actually better. I was only ill, it turned out, for about 10 weeks, so so it wasn't too bad. I've just woken up, got to clear things. Look at that, levitating bike. What do you think of that? There's no point driving on days like this, because There's nowhere I can park around here for 10 hours, 12 hours. So I suppose, what time is it? Sunrise is 6:40, 6:45, right. So somewhere over there, the sun's just come over the horizon, not that you'd know. I think I'm gonna start painting. One thing I didn't get on film, but always makes me sort of stop and take note. My studio's in Stokes Croft, and Stokes Croft is the sort of, let's call it the bohemian party capital, Bristol. And by that I mean there's loads of homeless people walking around drunk. But when you ride through Stokes Croft at 5:30 in the morning, you'll get the odd sort of early rising commuter on his bike or her bike, people walking their dogs, waiting at bus stops, but they're few and far between. What you mostly get is huge groups of people pissed out of their head, just staggering around, and there's more of them than there is in the day. It's weird, it's like they sort of, there's like a shift change. And normal people go home and have dinner and then go to bed, and then all the street folk sort of come out after bedtime and they stay up all night. So at any time of the night, if you walk through Stokes Croft, there'll just be loads of people as awake and sociable as we would be in the afternoon. Just thought it was interesting. The tide's out as well. River's quite shallow, all shiny mud. So we should see the tide do one and a half rotations today. So I'm gonna try and paint till half five. What would that be, 11 hours? 10 and a half. Oh, the other thing I need to address is some people got pretty ticked off that I wasn't gonna film full paintings anymore. That really didn't go down well at all. So there's a compromise that needs to be had, making thoughts on painting, and I do appreciate that people are interested in the painting process. So there's three ways to do it. There's time-lapse, which a lot of people don't seem very keen on, but that means no editing for me, and you see the whole painting, you see every brush stroke, and you see the mixing. That's one. Second option is I turn the camera on for 15 minute bursts and then have a 15 minute break with it off, and then 15 minutes on, 15 minutes off. So that'll be 6 or 8 edits for me, which wouldn't be that much hassle, but it's still a bit of a pain. And the third one is do what I've been doing, which is film entire paintings and then go in and either pull out 15 minute chunks out of an entire clip, or take out in every single individual brushstroke and have 300 edits, which is what I've been doing. So the last one will probably look the best, film the whole thing and then take selected 10 or 15 minute chunks. But that uses up a hell of a lot of memory stick. It will use up 2 memory sticks, 2 64 gig memory sticks in a day. If I painted 4 or 5 paintings, and probably flattened all the batteries. So there probably isn't the battery power to do that on most, there'd be just enough battery to do that. Definitely not on a 2-day, I'd have to charge up overnight and then dump all the footage onto an external hard drive or something, which I'm not gonna be able to do if I'm down in Cornwall. So I'm gonna experiment. I think the best way to do it is for me to turn the GoPro on for 10 minutes every now and again while I'm painting. It'll save the battery, it won't fill up the memory card, and you'll still get to see half or a third of the painting get done. So on this first one, my warm-up painting, I'm just going to try a time-lapse. So today will be an experiment for different sort of editing techniques. And you could let me know in the comments which one you like best. Right, shut up, Tom. Do some work. Okay, so that's the first one finished. Light changed quite a bit because the sun was literally coming up as I was painting it. And the first of three batteries is flashing that it's nearly run out. So I don't think time-lapse of whole paintings is gonna work. I think I'm gonna have to just turn the camera on after each painting today, because there's gonna be a lot of paintings. Or I might for the next one. Well, no, maybe I'll turn it on for a couple of 10-minute bursts during the next one. That'll be the next experiment of how to go about filming this, and filming this in series in general. So the painting, yeah, it went reasonably well. People always say, oh, background looks so far away. Well, that's because of the fisheye lens on the GoPro camera. But yeah, pretty pleased with that. It's not a bad start. So, how many more to go? 5, 6, 7? I don't know, 4 or 5 probably. It's getting cold as well. I should have brought more layers, very stupid of me. I'm gonna be here a long time not moving. And the clouds are coming in and it's getting very, very damp. And I haven't got a hot drink. Right, next painting. Okay, number two. My toes are cold already, which is not good. I'm underdressed for this. All I've got is a very thin long sleeve merino wool top and my jacket. No real insulation layers at all. Normally wear two coats. So I hope it warms up, or I'm going to struggle to make it to 6 o'clock. I really love the drawing part of a painting. I do compress this view ever so slightly. I mean, proportions aren't exactly spot on when I
I mean, I know they're not when I'm painting this now, but I make the bridges slightly, the bridge turrets slightly bigger, I think. Bit of artistic license. It's not the end of the world. Something really nice about getting up at 5, which sort of sounds counterintuitive, but I really like that saying, win the morning, win the day. There's something about getting up when the majority of people are asleep that appeals to me a lot. There's a definite excitement to that. To being awake when everyone else, well, not everyone, but when a lot of people aren't. Riding through Bristol when it's still dark. It's exciting. Why is drawing so satisfying? I never draw, just, you know, go out drawing. Ever, really. It doesn't interest me. A pencil and a sketchbook, I find it a bit boring, actually, and I don't like graphite. I don't really like using pencils. I like paint and brushes. And some people think that's really strange, that someone that like me that works, you know, from life the majority of the time wouldn't go out drawing. Why wouldn't I? Well, this is my drawing. Every time I do a painting, I have to get the drawing right before I start mixing colour. So as far as I'm concerned, I'm always drawing. I just prefer to do it like this. I'm just not interested in sketchbooks. I have done it. I have gone out with my sketchbook and a pencil, but invariably what ends up happening, if I do a good drawing, I'll just think, oh God, I could have painted that. I could have had a nice painting, which is infinitely more valuable to me than any drawing. Painting's what I'm interested in. And I see drawing as just an absolute necessary skill in order to make painting happen. If you can't draw, then you can't do this painting from life stuff. So I think drawing is very, very important, and I really enjoy it. I just choose not to do it in a sketchbook. So if someone says, oh, can I see your sketchbooks? It's like, well, look at my paintings. It's all in there. That'll do for now. It really is amazing how much the light in the scene can change just within an hour, really. Let alone a whole day. Makes plein air quite a tricky thing to do. Sorry about all the throat clearances. Horrible thing to listen to. It's my favourite bit of the whole painting. It's always doing this dark clump of trees that overhangs. What a mess. Sun's just hitting that. It's rather lovely. Talk about everything changing. I mean, already, massive difference. But that's plein air painting for you. Yeah, only so much you can do to cope with this. You see, so at this point it becomes more about how can I save this and still produce a nice painting with the colours that I've already got on, because really my head's telling me to wipe this off now, start again. I feel it might be a bit premature to do that, and a little bit of a shame. Hold off for the time being. See if I can make something of it. Where's my rigger? There it is. So tempting, isn't it, when the sun comes out to suddenly paint that fleeting light effect. But you're not going to get it. Well, sometimes you can. It's very, very, very rare. That's what photography's for. Catching those sunspots on the hillsides. Stuff that lasts 5 seconds. I think there's a Monet quote or something about that. I see a colour, I mix it, and 5 seconds later it's gone. That wasn't verbatim, that was I've completely butchered the quote, but I'm sure you can look it up. But yeah, he makes a good point. All of this is just the vain the vain attempt at getting an approximation of something beautiful. The days when you can actually really just nail the colours, the temperature of everything, all the temperature of all the colours perfectly. Those days are so, so rare. Oh wow, see, look at that cloud down the end there. Prime example. Gorgeous. I'd love to get that in, but I'd have to repaint the whole sky. That sky now is lovely. Really amazing. So hopefully in the next painting I'll be able to get that. So I don't really think it's going to happen in this one. Okay, I think you'll agree that there is a substantial difference between that and that. So I'm going to wipe this off. I thought that was going to probably be the case, as it looks like the weather's going to be a bit more consistent now. So yeah, number two didn't quite make it. So this will be number 2.5. Yeah. Get rid of this. Well, talk about the light changing. I mean, it doesn't get much more of a dramatic shift than that. Look how different this is. So yeah, wipe that one off. Which was the right thing to do, because 10 minutes after I started wiping it off, we're now at blue sky and full sun. So, will this last? Amazing, isn't it, how much everything can shift. Never ceases to amaze me. So let's go again. Still only got one painting done, so that's slightly annoying. So in my head I'm thinking, hopefully get 5 done between now and 6 o'clock. We'll have to see. So blue, isn't it? Wow. Really bright now. So as soon as you can see the shadow of your brush on the board, you know it's bright. Those pancakes are still definitely keeping me going. I'm sure the majority of you are not remotely interested in what I eat. But I thought it might just be something else the channel could have that wasn't painting related, but would still be relevant, I guess, to people that work outside. Still relevant to plein air painting, and that, you know, you've got to have a decent breakfast, I guess. But I love, I'm not going to say I'm a great cook, because I don't think I am, but I'm very enthusiastic. And I like experimenting a lot with a few simple dishes, and sort of just like mixing painting medium, if you tweak it ever so slightly, more flour, more eggs, less milk, more milk, it subtly changes it and everything makes a difference. So every morning I change the amount of individual ingredients. I change one thing each time, and so I know what's having the effect. If you change two things, it's hard to tell which has really had the effect, but if you only change one, same with anything in life, you'll get a good idea of what's making something taste or look the way it does, and it's the same with mixing medium. So I'll go through the ingredients and how I like to make it, the pancake mix, because I think it's lush. Whoops. So the water's coming up, definitely coming up. This is the Avon Gorge, the River Avon, going out into the Severn Estuary further up. I think has one of the highest, I can't get my words today, the widest tide, one of the widest tides in Europe. So the difference between the highest and the lowest point is significant. And I've seen this water, so this where I'm standing is completely underwater. I've seen it that high. This is completely flooded. I think there's a photo in the photo section of my website of that. So everything, the tops of all those concrete things out there, I think all of that, maybe all of that underwater, or at very least the water right up to the edge. That was pretty amazing. It just looked like a giant lake. Let me know in the comments if you'd rather I just shut up and painted, or whether you're happy for me to give commentary. I guess if you don't like it, you can always turn the sound down. One thing I've noticed from the comments section on YouTube is you can't please everybody. It's good to get feedback. I like that quote, there's no such thing as criticism, it's only feedback. I think it's a good way to look at it. It's the most fun bit really, isn't it, putting on the sky, so I thought I'd turn the camera straight back on. Clouds are racing across down there, but there's some lovely ones. So within 2 minutes of me starting this, whatever I see is gonna have gone. I'm gonna put one right there. I like that cool colour of that cloud. I think I'm gonna... The thing with skies is, I've come to the conclusion that it's more about observing colours out there. But as far as painting yours and your picture, it's more like design one rather than copy it. Because what are you going to copy? Changes every 2 minutes. There is a risk things start looking like the intro from The Simpsons on days like today. Those that bright blue sky and those big fluffy clouds, you know, you've got to be a little bit careful. Wow, so bright. Where's my blue sky gone? Now, I knew today wasn't going to be easy. And I'm up for a challenge. But this could prove to be a little bit harder than I anticipated. Seem to have a lot of sun in, sun out issues. So yeah, to anyone, any studio painters watching that haven't gone outside yet and quite fancy it, this is the kind of thing you have to contend with. If you're going out for the first time or planning to, I would highly recommend waiting for a calm day where it's either completely overcast, actually I'd recommend starting overcast, or sunny, cloudless, low wind, just so you've got that consistency, because it's very hard to tell if you've done something wrong if the thing you're looking at changes constantly. It's a lovely gorge, but this huge sort of face of rock in particular, I'm very fond of. Look at that, totally grey. I've got to stop again. I've got to wipe it off again. That does not look anything like that. I'm not sure today is going to be particularly successful. Watch this. Okay, we're back. Number three. Attempt number three. We haven't actually got three paintings done yet, have we? Has the weather settled down? I think it has. I definitely think it has. So, kind of hoping now that this will be number three in the bag. It was weird that, because the forecast wasn't bright sun. It was around this time, it was, you know, heavily overcast, which is what it is now, but we had that really profound break in the weather, of really lovely blue sky. So plein air painting is, it's mental resilience and physical hardiness to put up with the weather and the cold. They're all sort of really important aspects of it, which is why it's not for everyone. But if you're like me, if you're the sort of person that loves being outside and sort of enjoys that sort of hardship part of it, I say hardship, I mean, I can go home at any point, can't I? It's not hardship, but I think you know the point I'm trying to make. It's certainly harder than sitting in a studio with a cup of tea. But it's, I find that aspect of it sort of intensely pleasurable, the struggle. When I used to snowboard, when I was doing my seasons, the feeling, I still get it, like mountain biking, that feeling you get when you come home and you've been out in the saddle all day and you've really, really worked yourself. The feeling you get when you come home of satisfaction is so wonderful, and I can't think of any other way to get it. That, and I think the body is designed in many ways to exert itself. Going back to hunter-gatherers and all of that, you know, genetically we're sort of coded to exert ourselves, I think. And so when we do that in a day, there's this feeling of satisfaction, and I think it's the sort of ancient part of our brain going, yeah, I love that. That's what I like. More of that, please. But in the modern world, it's very, very easy, isn't it, to deny ourselves that, because we don't have to. We don't have to stay outside when it's cold. We don't have to go and find food. We have to go and find Sainsbury's. So I think struggle is a good thing. Self-imposed hardship. You can't feel good unless you felt denied of those things that make you feel good. It's the contrast, isn't it, that makes you feel happy in a lot of ways. Yin and yang, man. But yeah, I think it's true. I do. It's actually quite a stormy sky coming. My coat's waterproof, but it's not. I haven't really got enough thermals on to feel comfortable if it gets much colder than this, which is a bit of a worry. Is that sky all right? You've got the most amount of freedom, I think, in when you're painting skies out of any part of the painting. You know, if you're going to go crazy, the sky's the place to do it. But they are not easy things to paint. I still struggle with them, really. Claimed that they'd sort of cracked an element of painting, like implying that they had it locked down every time, I would be deeply sceptical of that claim. It's weird, you'll learn something. Like, have a really good day maybe you've learnt to do a technique, or you've learnt a way to paint trees or something that really works for you. And sometimes you'll go home and you'll be thinking, yeah, I got that nailed. I don't have to worry about painting trees or whatever anymore. That's one less problem I have to worry about. And then you go out again a couple of days later, armed with this knowledge, and you try and apply it in a different setting at a different spot. So, and guess what? It doesn't work. That's really hard to cope with, because it does happen. And then you go home thinking, what's going on? What do I have to do to make this work? And that's sort of the cruel part about painting a lot of the time. You'll get lulled into this sort of false sense of security that you've cracked a certain element of it. I'm not sure there is any cracking of anything. It's not as simple as that. And that's that's the sort of thing that keeps you up at night. Well, it used to keep me up. It doesn't so much anymore. I've stopped worrying about it. But, yeah. She's a cruel mistress, plein air. So, struggling. It's changed again, obviously. We've now got this really high contrast between the sky and the ground, and I haven't got that on my painting. Oh, so I think this is probably a wiper as well. I think number three is going to have to come off. I think what it really needs is this. That's a significant improvement. This is quite fun, actually. So if your painting hasn't gone entirely to plan, you can improve it. No end. With a few little alterations. Yeah. Should we? I think I might submit this to the John Moore. I'm going to keep that ridiculous mess. I think that's quite funny. Right. I need a coffee. Been here about 4 hours now, so my feet are a bit numb. So I'm going to go and get a decaf flat white. Because I'm a wuss and I can't handle caffeine. Used to drink tons of it, and then stopped as an experiment. Felt 100 times better, slept better, didn't feel as irritable or anxious in the day. Yeah, give it a whirl. You might be surprised. Yeah. Okay. See you after the break. So, here we go again. Number four. That coffee was nice. Yeah, if you've been painting for 4 hours straight, it's good just to give your eyes a rest, really. You end up to just not looking properly after a while. You just get fatigued. Looks pretty consistent now. Got a good feeling about this one. We'll see how it goes. Yes. Look how dark that sky is coming over. Good thing about the drawing stage is the light changing doesn't affect it. So I sketch it out and I'm like, yes, yeah, it's working. Well, of course it's working. You haven't put any colour on yet. So, what are the odds on this going pear-shaped? By the looks of that cloud, I'm saying 50-50. It's not a great success so far, is it, today? Oh well. Yeah, it's all getting rather dramatic. I hope you can hear me over the wind. I forgot my windsock again from the GoPro. Well done, Tom. Wow. It's turning black out there. Alarm going off in the background. It's not at all annoying. And it stopped. think I need to speed up. Quicker I paint, the less chance it's got to change. And then you're balancing or compromising accuracy for speed, which is always a problem. Okay, I hope you can hear me over the wind noise. I'm sorry I didn't bring the windbreak, but I think this one is, it's gonna make it. So, just going to put the water reflections in, but I think this one's worked. It's not an easy thing to do, painting outdoors. I mean, it sometimes feels like the ones that do work, the ones that go right, because of how many go wrong, sometimes the ones that go right sort of can feel like, not flukes, but sort of, like you really sort of get lucky. nerve-wracking actually putting these big wind ripple marks onto the water. I don't want to cover the whole thing in ripples, like ruin it. Bridge. See, do that in the studio and the sky is dry. Make more sense, wouldn't it? Less risk mucking up a nice painting.
Stop for lunch now. I feel I've clawed back a little bit of dignity. So that's what, 4 attempts and 2 paintings finished, which is 50%, which is pretty standard. It's pretty normal, really. What time is it? 1:45. Another 5 hours, hopefully get 2 more, but we'll see what the light does. I'm a bit worried about how cold I am as well. A bit of hypothermia never killed anyone. Actually, I think it did. So what's lunch? Doesn't look very appetizing, but it is pasta, chicken and bacon. Bit of mayo. Right, see you in a bit.
Okay, about to start number 5. 2 done so far, finished, 2 wiped off. Look how much the tide's come in now. this is all pretty getting close to highest point, maybe another half an hour. So I don't really like the scene as much when the tide's this high. I find it sort of overwhelms it a bit, but I'm gonna do another one. You've probably seen me sketch this out enough, so maybe I'll skip this bit. I changed my mind, this is kind of one of the funnest bits, so I'll leave the camera on. Thank you. And now the sun's come out. Oh. Not sure whether to wait or just to get on with it.